Hey, what's going on, guys? It's Caleb, and today I'm announcing a pretty cool series that I've been pretty excited about, and I was thinking of a name for it all today, just trying to come up with a name for, you know, what I thought fit for it, and I think I'm just going to be calling this Recreating. So it's going to be like recreating and then the name of whatever we're recreating, and in this episode, we're going to be doing the Stranger Things intro opening credits. This basically this title graphic, and I'm not going to be doing the entire thing because it's 50 seconds long, but I wanted to get the main shot in. So this ending piece here, where all the text kind of comes together, and I also want to cover the, because this, if you haven't watched this show, I highly encourage you to. It's a Netflix original, and all of the episodes came out at one time. It's very heavily influenced on a lot of 80s television shows and movies. I believe in an interview they talked about being very influenced by the Goonies. I forget what other one was. But I remember the Goonies being a big one, and that really did play off with the group of kids in the show. It was really great. But this isn't the place for me to give my whole opinion on the show. But I do highly suggest going to watch this. But the entire aesthetic of this intro is going to be 80s, very minimalistic. And one of the things you're going to be seeing with the text on the screen is that it has a very interesting sort of fade to it. It doesn't naturally fade. It actually, it's seen best here. It turns red. The text actually will turn red and then fade away. So I also want to cover that. So there we go. It's really subtle, but in a lot of 80s movies I saw this, the text wouldn't just kind of fade away. It would fade into red and then fade out. And I really, like, basically with these recreating things, I'm going to be finding things that I find interesting, and then just trying to recreate them. And there's some things, I'm not going to be doing this 100% to the T, because I would go through and recreate all of this, but as you can see, the text is very detailed, and it's like 3D. I believe the text is like slightly 3D, there's definitely some depth to it. And as you can see, the lighting on it is very professional, but I'm just going to be doing this with 3D text or 2D text, and just using strokes and using probably, I might use some lights. I don't really know, because I'll probably just give each text layer its own glow, because as you can see that there's some glow coming off the edges. The lighting is definitely lights being used. But yeah, this is what I'm going to be recreating mainly. And then the strokes come in, and those are cool. And I saw this, and I was watching it on TV, and I was like, this is a very minimalistic approach to this. Like, I could probably recreate this in probably like at least an hour. I'm gonna be trying to do these things, I guess, as a sort of like a challenge. I'll be trying to create these within an hour, and I just thought the series would be really cool for everyone involved. Like, I have really fun a lot of fun recreating things on my Beyonce. There's a couple recreations I already did. I did one for Between, which is a Netflix original, and I did one for MLS. So I'll probably go through and recreate those again for the series eventually. But so yeah, here's what we're gonna be doing. The Stranger Things opening graphic. Yeah, all right, let's get to it. So we're gonna be doing just a new composition. 1920 by 1080, 30 frames a second, because that works for me. Cool. Duration. What I'm going to start off with here is I am basically just going to get the idea of what I'm going to make this. So this is going to be going. This whole series is going to be going through kind of like my workflow, just how I think. You know, I'm going at this very improvised, because when I'm making things, I go more towards a far more improvised approach instead of planning everything out, because I seem to have better outcomes whenever. The things I do are just more improvised than planned. I don't know why. It seems to be kind of backwards, but that's how it works. But yeah, I'm just going to kind of just make this logo thing here, and then just get the idea of what I'm looking for. So I did download the font recently. What was it? I believe it was Benguet. I believe that's how you pronounce it. I believe that's the font that I'm looking for. I believe it was Benguet. Was the font they used there, and the text, the font that they used for the, like, the names and stuff of people is Avant-Garde Extended Bold, I believe that's what it was. But let's see if this is correct. So Stranger Thing, and it would probably all be in caps. I probably need to move my microphone and keyboard over a little bit. All right, that works, whatever. Stranger Things, and it was Benguet. Bing. Okay. Yes, that looks right. All right. So there we go. We're basically done. Stranger Things, there it is. No, so this is all being done through no fill. There's no fill to this logo, as you can see. It's all a stroke. There's no actual fill color to it, which is interesting, and I kind of like that. So we're gonna do no fill color, and we are going to do that kind of orangish red. Let's see here. Let's kind of go down a little bit more. Gonna find that color. Yeah, there we go. That's what I'm looking for. Like there, I guess. We'll probably go back and color that up a little bit better. But for now, that works fine. And it's definitely, yeah. So you're also gonna notice that the S and the R are bigger than the rest, which I find really attractive. I like that a lot. So let's just go ahead and make the S up to what we wanted at. Want like 202, and we could probably just lower this down a little bit. It might be easier to actually just do this with the S and the R being on their own layers. I think that's probably going to make our lives a little bit easier. So let's just do an S there, and simply just scale that up. So there, because as you can see, the S and the R are bigger, but at the same time, they're staying in line with the rest of the text. I believe the R is still, or, yeah, things are still resting there. So that's truly what we're looking for. The S and the T are going to be spaced out pretty well to each other. Yeah, they're pretty close. This is definitely, as you can see, it is this font, but if you take a look at the end of the S and the T, clearly there was some editing done to the font to make it special to this thing, because the S and the T aren't going to fit perfectly together like they do in the logo, because this one was edited a little bit, because they're definitely different. The S and that S don't match up properly, unless this is a lowercase s. Could that be the case? No, I'm not thinking so. I'm thinking that they edited it a little bit. So there we go. I'll just duplicate that layer and make an R. So, I mean, obviously, we don't have the absolutely perfect assets, but we'll make it work with what we got. So let's move this up a little bit to make it in line with the rest of the text. Yeah, I'll move that over to the right. Move this over to the left a little bit more. And let's see. Yeah, I guess. It looks fine. Okay. I guess so. Yeah, the S is bothering me a little bit. Like, I'm pretty OCD about that S right now because it just doesn't look great. But when you're recreating stuff like this, you kind of gotta work with what you got. I guess I'll move that up a little bit. Maybe that'll help. No, probably down. Okay. I'll stop being weird. All right, there we go. That works fine. All right. And I think the tracking needs to be... So probably all my work there, centering all that up, was probably for nothing. Yeah, definitely. Definitely have to have these letters to be a little closer together. And this is just a draft right now. Like, I'm basically just trying to get the idea of exactly what I'm looking for. And then I'll just use this as a reference, you know? Because if I could use this as a reference, this thing, all I want, like, I could just make this my reference. But obviously the font... There's a little bit going on there that we're not going to be able to account for. Like the S, for example, there's definitely some things being changed, but this is a good start. So, Stranger Things. There we go. Now we have like our own little logo going on there. And that was pretty easy. And it looks pretty nice, actually. I like that. So yeah, now let's get to animating. I guess I should also, in this draft, should just put together that glow, because there's definitely some glow going on here. I want to make the first glow done on an adjustment layer, so it is entirely, it's covering the entire block of text. And if I in this tutorial, if I kind of like jump from thing to thing, this is just my workflow. This is just how I act. I just do really, I'm very all over the place. So hopefully this ends up turning out fine. But yeah, so there we go. Now we have that glow going on, and it's going to be covering up this entire block here, like this entire thing. And the cool thing about adjustment layers and using effects is that if I want, like, I could go ahead and mess with how strong I want this glow to be in the actual thing here. But since I'm just using this on an adjustment layer itself, I could just lower this to like 70%, and it will make it a lot more subtle for me automatically. So that's the cool thing about using adjustment layers, especially with glows. So I want that to be like, I think that looks good. Yeah. Okay. And I'm gonna go through and change some colors because they're not exactly where they need to be. And I could probably just go ahead and take a screenshot of this and grab some colors from it. This is usually what I do. I'll just take a screenshot of something, then grab the colors and put it into my project, and then be like, okay, I'll just use this. I'm stealing the colors, basically. So there we go. We'll just put that. We'll just throw that right over here. I guess I could also use it as a reference too. I could kind of like put that there and be like, oh, I'm gonna line these things up. Okay, cool. Now I want to. I guess I'll just go through and change the coloring of these to match that. There we go. Just grab all that. And change my stroke color to be matching of. Hold on. Cancel. Let me just kind of zoom in here. Go away. Let's take that. Zoom in there so I can better look at it. I'll just make this full so I can see it properly. All right. So for the stroke color, I want to get the best I can out of it, like the most. So kind of like there, I guess. I think that is what I'm looking for. Is that what I'm looking for? Yes, that is probably what I'm looking for. So that works, and I will just it's a little too brown. I think I can lighten that up just a little bit by changing, bringing this higher. Yeah, that'll probably work. All right, so I will just not do that. I grab my S. Let's take the colors over from this guy. If it wants to do it, yeah, collect it from that guy. Looks like the S is getting a little more light. And actually, you know what I should do? I should just turn off the adjustment. That's what's messing me up. So you turn off that adjustment layer. Don't do that. Grab this guy. Let's grab him. Okay, let's grab that. Boom, perfect. Grab that. Probably taking way too long to do this right now. So that's good. Okay, awesome. And then let's turn back on that adjustment layer. Cool. All right, now I'll just take away that screenshot for a little while. I want to go through and change a few more things with this. I kind of want to mess with the threshold and the intensity and the radius. Okay. And we're just using the original colors on this glow. So I think that looks fine. Yeah. And obviously, like judging from the example, a few text layers kind of have like their own shine to them. Which we'll get to that. But for now, this is working for me. So I think I want to get to animating now. Now I need to do a little bit of looking into what exactly happens in here. Because like I said, we're doing this kind of improvised. So let's take a look at what letters are moving. So it looks like the A, the N, the G, the R. So RANG are simply all it's happening to them. Is the tracking is being animated on them to make them come together. So we know that, and I probably want to put this down like a text document, notepad or something. just so I can remember properly. So ring tracking only. There we go. So simple enough. Tracking is being animated to make the letters be spaced out and come together. Cool. Looks like the T drops down from the top of the screen. The S comes in from the left. The E comes down. The R comes in from the right. And it looked like the other T also came in. No. Does the N come in too? The N comes in. The I and the G are having their tracking animated. The H and the S are coming in. Okay. And then the lines come out. We'll worry about the lines later. We really don't need to worry about that right now. Okay. Cool. And to me, it actually looks like... I could probably keep my adjustment layer glow, but it looks to me like each letter has its own glow applied to it, because it kind of looks like the glow follows the letters. So I might have to go through... I might just do this entire thing letter for letter, because I think that would make my life a lot easier. I'll make the letters according to what happens in the animation. So rang, they all come together, so I'll make that its own layer. And then the I and the G, I'll just space those out. I'll just put a space in between them to make room for the N. Okie doke. Cool. All right, so let's just go ahead and make a new composition and see where it goes from. All right, so let's make that black background. Cool, awesome. Now let's start with... Let's just kind of remake it again, but this time using the correct format, so we have all of them in according layers. So let's start with RANG, because that's probably going to be our easiest to do. So RANG, tracking, put those together a little more. Further than that. There, it's fine. I kind of want them to be touching. Okay, cool. Now using a line, just put that in the center. These series are definitely not going to be like tutorials. These are just going to be kind of me having fun. Hopefully you'll learn something along the way. Something like that. All right, cool. Rang. She rang my telephone. Cool. All right, now I'll just put that up top. And now this is its own layer, so I can actually animate the tracking within the text itself to just give it that look. So that'll work fine. All right, cool. So now let's just do, the T comes in from the top. So let's just do the T next and kind of just put that in the correct place. So we'll just duplicate the ring because it's already in the correct place it needs to be. And then we're just gonna make T its own layer because we're gonna be animating the position on that itself. So we'll just put that there. There we go, Trang, awesome. And then the S comes in from the left. So then let's just make that S its own layer. Awesome, and let's increase the size of that bad boy so he's right there, a little lower, a little more to the right, probably a little bigger. There we go. Awesome. And then the E, what happens to the E? I believe the E comes in from the top as well, yeah? Yeah, the E comes in a little bit after the T. So we will make the T an E. Here we go. We'll just put that into where it needs to go. So like right there, a little more to the right so the E and the G aren't like colliding and forming their own super letter. Here we go. And the R comes in from the right. So we'll just duplicate the S because it's already in the correct scale and placement. And then we will put that there. Not an E, an R, silly. Here we go. All right, stranger. Looks fine to me. Yeah, that looks good. Okay, now for things. What do we need to do for things? I believe the I and the G were cool. They're buds. Yeah, the I and the G come together. And like I said, I'm just gonna make, like, I'm gonna put a space there for just an empty space so that I can animate the tracking on them easily, but there'll be room for that N to come in. So we'll just simply duplicate the rang. Hit rang. And I space G probably a little farther apart, just so there is room for that. And for all the movements, we will probably just use a camera. So it's going to be our easiest option. We could use a null, but it doesn't really matter. And one thing I noticed with the Gs is that it was really interesting. It looks like they kind of, if you watch the G, it looks like it kind of collides into something. I'm not sure what does that. I don't know why they chose to do that. It looks cool, don't get me wrong. It's just a very weird decision. It looks like the N kind of like influences the way the G is going to, like, it kind of pushes it, almost. This G does it too. It's weird. I don't know why they did that. I guess to maybe make room for the N's? I'm not sure. But yeah. And a good point of reference is that the N needs to be directly below the other N. So we'll know exactly what we need to do to make that happen and how much space needs to be between the I and the G. So it looks like the I is a little bit past the N, and the G is directly below the other G. So, cool. Just put that. Space that out like one more time. Yeah, and we'll pull the tracking in a little bit. About like there. Take this eye. I will move that. Okay, I think that will work. So just gotta move this over to the. Yeah, I guess so. Who knows? Maybe it's easier at this point to just do this, like at the I and the G on their own text layers, but I don't really care. That works, I guess. There you go. Okay, cool. Just having fun with it. Nothing. This isn't anything. This isn't going to be actually used in the show, so anything that's not proper design-wise is totally cool with me. Okay, so now let's just simply do the N, and we'll just copy over the T. The T will work. And hopefully, all my estimating was correct. And actually, you know what? Forget that. I want them to be correctly aligned, so I'm just going to copy the N, or the G, I and G to make this. So here we go. Put that, hopefully, correct spot. It looks to me like that will work. I think the I and the G need to be spaced out just a little bit more. Like, just not that much. Like, that much. Like a hair. There we go. Cool. Now, what else do we need to do? I believe the rest of them are going to be on their own layers. Yeah, the H, the G, and the S are all on their own, doing their own thing. So we'll just copy over the N and an S there. Put that guy right there. So it's almost touching that R, but not 100%. You know, it's like almost there. It's kind of debating. Like Nemo, when he's trying to touch the butt. He's about to, but he was like, no, I'm not going to. But then he did anyways. Finding Nemo. Spoilers. Over there. Don't touch the butt, kids. Don't touch the butt. Alright. The H. Now the T. Stranger Things. And it looks to me like that's almost perfect. Except for the fact that this is a little off-center. So what I'm going to do is I am just going to grab all of these guys. So we have the I, the N. That should be all of it, except I need a G. I have the G already. Okay, cool. So I just need to center this out a little bit more. So it's right in between that. We're going to be using the S, the big S and the R, for ideas of where the center is going to be at. So that looks like it needs to be over to the left a little bit more. So we'll just put that there. And There we go. And I believe it's going to be, yeah, it's going to need to be, well, maybe. Maybe not. Is that looking snazzy enough? I think it just doesn't look like it's centered properly because the G is not directly below the other G and stuff. But that's fine. That looks good enough to me. So yeah, there you go. Cool. And now with this, all of our layers are in the correct places so that we can animate them properly. So now I can move the I and the G's tracking, and I can animate the S to come on its own, and you know, that's just the way you gotta do it. Sometimes you just gotta put each letter on their own layer, so yeah. Alright, so now let's actually get to animating. So we're not gonna worry about the zoom out movement right now, because like I mentioned earlier, we're just gonna be doing that through a camera, so it's really not gonna matter. Or I might do it through a null object. I don't know, maybe. Or I'll probably just end up pre-composing it actually, and then just zooming it out. Alright, so first thing that I'm gonna do is I'm just going to forget about the bottom line entirely so that I don't have a bunch of things blocking my view. I'm gonna arrange these a little bit better. So this, all of this, that bottom line there, I believe. So if I just move this up there, yeah. So I'm just going to make this easier to understand for me. I'm gonna make it spell out things stranger. Yeah, so there we go. And I'm going to use my best friend, the Shy, to shy up all those layers and get rid of them so that I don't have to look at them. And I will also turn the visibility off on all those guys so that I don't have to see them either. So there we go. Got to shy those layers. Awesome. So now we have Stranger. Now looking at this, I definitely want my R to be a little more to the right. And the S maybe to come in a little more. If I bring the S in more, then the R needs to come in more. I liked where it was at before. That's fine. All right, cool. So let's just do, let's focus on Rang first. So let's just get rid of the rest of these guys and just focus on Rang. So Rang, the tracking on that one is being animated. So we go open up that text layer and grab tracking. And now we can just move these letters apart as much as we want to. And let's just take a look at how quickly they kind of come in and how far apart they get spaced away from each other. It doesn't look like they're spaced out that far, like hardly any at all. Yeah, so just a little bit. Like not much, not very much. What's up, man? What's up, man? What's going on? Well, I didn't notice that either. It looks like the R and the A kind of connect to form their own thing. So I didn't do that, but that's kind of cool. That's why I love design so much. You can just get so creative with it. So yeah, the A, the N, the G kind of come in together pretty quickly. I'd give it about, what, like, that's probably like an eased movement over, well, actually the G is a little bit staggered, but I'm not going to go back and do that, but I didn't notice it at first, but I should have put the G and Rang on its own layer. Which I didn't do. And the R, too, I guess. Yeah, but it really won't make much of a difference. In this version of Stranger Things, it's going to be... The Rang is going to all come in together at once. So I'd give it a... It's going to slowly come in over time. It looks like it goes on pretty long. So let's just animate the tracking amount to go to 0 over... How long is this thing? This thing's probably like 15 seconds, so... Is it 15 seconds? I think it might be. Yeah, it's probably a little longer than that. I guess 20. Like 25, I guess? Yeah, I'd say 25. So we'll just make it over like there. Trim the comp. So it's just over time, it's just going to get down to there. And we'll probably bring it to like 20. Say like there. So now over time our text tracking is going to come together like that, and let's bring it up a little more, and I'm going to go ahead and just simply F9 to ease these guys. Take a look at that in the graph editor, see what we got going on. Less than that. Yeah. I'm liking that. That looks fine to me. Starts off kind of slow, progresses to get a little bit faster, and then kind of slows down. There we go. Looks good. Very, very smooth movement. Pretty simple. You know, nothing, just tracking. Nothing crazy. Now what do we want to do? Now that we have that done, what do we want to do next? I think I want to do the R. I want, oh no, the R is part of the ring. Dang, I keep forgetting that. I should put those on their own layers. Let's do the T. So the T will simply just come in over time. Say to like, I'll probably bring that in a little more. From like, when does that end up becoming available? How about we do it like this? How about we move it? So at 5, 4 tracking becomes good for me to place it in there. Yeah, it's like 4. How about we move, place a keyframe down here, get rid of that, and then bring it to 0, like a little bit longer afterwards. So Rang goes over to 4, and then 4 goes down to 0. So here is where I want the T to officially be in between the R, the A, the N, the G. I want it to land at this point. So before then, the T is just going to be being moved up over time. So like starting at like here, be up there, and I will just ease those. Kinda mess with that a little bit. I don't want the influence of the speed to get too high, but definitely like a fast to slow. Because it's hardly even gonna be noticeable. Yeah, definitely a little slower than that. I don't even know, depending on the zoom, we're not really gonna know when the text is gonna be fully seen. Like, I don't even know when I'll be able to see the T. But I want it to, I guess it can cross paths with the R. Yeah, I think that looks fine. That should work. So it's very smooth. It goes down into place. Looking fancy. So next let's just do the exact same thing to the E. So let's put that on there. And then, yeah, we can just do the same thing to the E. We can just copy the movement. And we will stagger it. So, oh, actually, never mind, because that's going to put it in that position. I'm a dummy. So when is the E available? The E can be put in here, which is good because that's where it needs to be at. So put it over there, and then far out, we will put it up. So the E kind of comes in a little bit later. Again, just mess with these. Make sure they're not getting too fast. Definitely probably farther out than that. Okay. I think that's fine. I think I actually want to make these movements happen a little bit better. A little bit better. So there. Just mess with the speed a little more. What I'm doing here is, by the way, I am messing with my speed. I am seeing in the graph how fast things are moving, and I'm controlling them so I can get smoother movements. I usually prefer to go fast to slow. Just because I think that's the smoothest possible movement you can get with text. I always use fast to slow movements, and I'm using motion 2 to get those. because it's easy. It's a lot easier to get those. So that looks smooth to me. Let's space that out a little more. Ooh, okay, that's not looking too good. That is looking anything but good, because it kind of like slams together because of that other movement. So let's just even these out. Just make this, not controlling both of those, just this one. Just this one, please. It could be kind of like a hill, I guess. Is it gonna look bad though? No, that's fine. Okay, cool. And the E come in a little, yeah. Cool. Now we're done with all that. So, what's next? We got the S and the R. So that's all we have left for this bit here. So the R comes in first. I'm wondering if this is happening all too slow. Yeah, I'm getting the feeling that it's all happening a little too slow. So what I gotta do here is grabbing all these keyframes and pulling them in will work. Okay, let's just get an idea of what we're working with here, because I kind of want to see exactly what's happening. So I'm just going to do a quick RAM preview to see how fast these things are happening, and I can judge from that what changes need to be made. Because this is all happening over 20 seconds, and I think in that video, all of that's happening over about 10 to 15 seconds, so we're going a little too long with it. So the ring is coming together there, and the T starts to fall in, and then the E falls in as well. Yeah, literally, like, it kind of looks like it's in slow motion. So what we're going to do here is we are going to let that happen, and then we want the T position, the T movement to happen faster. And yeah, okay, I get it. So happens there, that comes in, check the speed of that to make sure it's not too fast, not like it's being rushed in, but that it's definitely getting there in time. There we go. And then the E will come in shortly after. Let's just again check the speed of that too to make sure that's all good. Nice, fast to slow, but subtle. So the T gets there, and then the E gets there. The E needs to get there faster. So it's, I want it to be like a little bit behind. Yeah, that looks good to me. So that's better, I think. I think that's better. There we go, okay. And now the R. The R is going to be there, it's gonna start to be into frame about when that E is settling. So I want my R to just simply come out from the right side and then settle into place. So the R will start to move like here. And that's where it will fit best. I'll just ease that. Move this over to the right. Not too far off the screen because the zoom will account for that. And if I do need to make adjustments, I can definitely just do that a little later. Just look at here. Oh yeah, that needs to be adjusted heavily. Smooth that out. Don't brainstorm. Don't need that. The brainstorm feature is kind of cool, actually. The brainstorm feature is interesting. Slower, please. Like demanding things about. Slower, please. Alright, there we go. That's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for a nice. Looks like a little mountain. Like a very, very, very. Not a very spiky mountain, just a tiny little mountain. That's what I need. That's what I'm looking for. Perfect. That's it. There it is. Okay. This is coming along nicely. I'm liking this. I just love remaking things. Like, that's one of my things I've found out I enjoy doing recently, is just remaking things and seeing what I can make of them. And from the intro, it looks like the S comes in a little bit after the R, so we'll have it start coming in from this position. No, not there. I think it was a little bit after, the R had settled, right? Does the R settle yet? Okay, the R is, settling when the S comes in. So we need it to start coming in, here. So just pull up in the position. And we'll just move it to, there. Move that off to the left. Use that, too. Let's grab these guys. Make these how we want them. Cool. Nice little mountain. Probably slower. Just a little bit slower. There it is. Okie doke. Let's have that come in faster. Not faster, just earlier. That will not do. That needs to be faster. How about that? I think so. I think what we need to do is just make that happen, just move the keyframes out a little bit more, so that it's not being rushed into place as much, but it's definitely, yeah, I think that's what we're looking for. Cool. So now we have a stranger done, and that looks excellent. And we're going to be starting, to give you an idea, we're going to be starting from, here. This is where the zoom is going to happen initially. So the R and the S and the T and the E, they're going to be off screen, so we won't even notice those. So that's cool. All right, cool. Think that works. That's good, yeah? There we go, we got Stranger done. Cool. Now let's do things, because that's the next thing we have to do here. The next Stranger Things. It's the next thing that we need to do here. I'm such a lame person. So lame, man. All right, so things. Cool. Here we go. So now we have all these. Actually, I think I'm going to need these to be on, because I'm going to need to use those for reference of movement. So we'll just keep those on. Okay. So, yeah. All right. So what happens to things during this movement? What happens there? So the I and the G, I remember that. The I and the G have their movement coming together. And then the N kind of slides up in there between them. The T comes from the left side of the screen. The H and the S slowly come up. Simple stuff. This intro is very minimalistic. It's very just, it is what it is. It's not complex. They obviously had a vision in mind for it, and they achieved it. They weren't wanting something on a super high budget. Certainly, this could have been made very quickly. And I like it. I like simple intros like this. So let's just do the I and the G first. So I'm just going to turn off all of these and leave the I and the G on their own. And the exact same thing that we did with the ring, we're going to do with the I and the G. So let's just pull up the tracking. Cool. And when does that happen? When exactly does that movement happen? Because that happens in the initial thing there. Right? In the first shot, you can see. Yeah, you can see the I and the G in the first shot. So this will have to happen in correspondence with that ring. So when ring shows up, I and G is also going to be there moving. So, oops, not that. Just tracking them out. So yeah, just put that there. Space these out. Nothing too crazy. Yep. All right, and to get an idea, I wanna unshy ring and see how long that lasts for. So that goes to there. Yes, that will work. That will work fine. And then we'll just slide the end between there. Yeah, we'll just slide up the end. It's the next thing we'll do. So yeah, there's definitely plenty of room for the end to get in there. And the end gets in, let's see. So the I and the G, so yeah, it's pretty early on. So I'd say like, probably move that in a little bit. Sort of like, about here is where the N would come in. So the N, all we're gonna do is have that guy off screen, hardly. We'll move him down to like there. I think that'll work. Mess with those, graph editor. That guy back, that guy back. There we go. So he kind of comes in. There we go. That looks good. Okie doke. Alrighty. Now the, what are we gonna do next? Because this one's pretty simple. This one's pretty straightforward. So the T is the next thing that comes in, but you can see the H. He's hanging around there. So we'll just do the T next. The T is having a movement coming in from the left, and you can kind of see him when the N is about here. That's when he first starts to show. He starts to show up a little bit before that. So let's just say he's off screen here and then comes in a little bit farther ahead. So there we go. Move him to like there. We'll pull open that guy in the graph editor. Simple stuff. Cool, I like that. And the H and the S both come in from the bottom of the screen, right? Yeah, okay. So we'll, the H comes in first, so we'll just do that one. And the H comes up with that T, so let's just have him come in about here. So that's when he'll start making his entrance. So we'll move him back, have him last a little longer. Move him down here. Pretty straightforward stuff. It's got to think about what comes in next, what goes where. It's kind of like a puzzle. It's a good way to describe what we're doing right now. Move those keyframes back a little bit, so they're kind of like in line with the T. And then the S. Does the S come in last? Is that the last thing that comes in? Or it kind of comes in with the S and the R in the top row, yeah? Yeah, for sure. I think the E needs to actually come in slower. I think that's what also I think that needs to happen. I think the S and the R also need to come in a little bit slower too. So let me just grab those guys. Yeah, definitely. A little slower. There we go. So I need to actually go back and make sure the S comes in a little later. Yeah, okay. I think that we'll go back, probably go back and refine that later, but for now that works better for what I'm doing. And then the S is going to be doing the exact same thing as that H, but we'll have him come in a lot slower. He'll probably be noticeable. He'll just be farther down. So yeah, let's move him like a little bit farther down than that H. I think that'll work fine. Okie doke. Closer in, moved back a bit. So how's that looking right now? Okay, what I'm thinking is that T needs to come in a little bit sooner. So that T needs to be like on its way. So there's some movement happening. So that's cool. Man, like,
just, I gotta stop for a second, man.
Like, take a second to appreciate, like, just what this looks like behind the scenes. Like, when you're watching an intro like this, this is how it looks, like, with the angles and stuff and, like, all that. Oh, it's so cool. Like, being able to make stuff like this is just awesome. Like, it's just really cool. I just have to say that first, because it's so cool. Like, just seeing how all this stuff fits together, and it's just really cool, man. Yeah, okay. So, there we go. We have that happening. I think that looks fine. I'm going to do a quick RAM preview to see how this all actually looks, and then we will admire it together. Or maybe we won't. Maybe we'll throw up because it looks bad. I'm not sure. But yeah, the angles that we're working with here are going to do everything for this piece. Like, having it all revealed like this is really going to depend upon the angles. So this is what it looks like right now. That's looking good. I'm thinking that definitely that S and the R need to come in quicker. Yeah, they need, or I don't think they need to come in quicker. I think they move just fine. But I'm thinking that they need to actually happen sooner. So I'll just grab this guy's keyframes and move him back. Or actually... the R needs to come in first, so we'll move him back, and then we will increase that there. And I also kind of wanted to go into this graph editor and make this slower, because I felt it was a little bit fast. Let's move that back a little bit. So yeah, the S is pretty behind there, so let's move him back. Maybe a little slower, so it kind of is in correspondence with that S. Yeah, I like that. I think that looks good. And I think what we're going to do is we're going to go back and kind of like add the glow and all the fancy stuff that is used to help the text look better. We'll just do that afterwards, but for now, let's just do the angle. So the main angle we're looking at here is the one that starts here. So... the camera is like in between, it's in the center, clearly. It starts off to where you can kind of see, you can see the I and the G is kind of cut off. So instead of pre-compose, let's just try a camera. And now let's observe, let's use a 24 millimeter. Let's just observe how this looks, like how fast the camera goes out, because we can kind of determine the easing. It is being done through, I believe those are linear keyframes. Yeah, that's very linear. As what I mean by linear is that it's moving out equally. It's not getting faster to slower. It's not going slower to fast. It's just being evenly moved and zoomed out. So with the camera, we're just gonna go ahead and open up the camera options and the zoom here. And actually, I need to go and make all of these 3D so that I can move the camera. Okay, so the zoom, we will have it start, let's just go to the beginning of our thing here, and we will zoom all the way to here. We'll have it to where that G is just cut off. That looks good. And obviously some things aren't going to be exactly how they need to be because I kind of messed up in the beginning with the R and the G, but that's fine. So let's have this zoom out all the way over to 20 seconds. And we will see, I believe it started off at like 1200. So it's like there. And we're already in linear keyframes. So that's gonna work just fine. Okay. So now what I'm thinking is that I actually want to move this to be zoomed out a little more. Like, how far zoomed out is it at this point? It's like there, okay. Okay. The one thing that I'm seeing is that the S and the R, no, maybe they're fine. Yeah, I think they're fine. So there we go. I think that looks good. So luckily, I did everything accordingly, and the camera angle did work how I wanted it to. It concealed everything that was on screen when it didn't need to be shown, and the camera angle is working correctly to show things when they need to be shown. So what I mean by that is, like, I kind of moved things off screen, and in my mind I kind of figured where the camera would be at that point of them being off screen. So so you know, like, here the H is here, and so in my mind I figured at that point the camera would be at the, like, here. So all that worked out fine. I think for the most part it's pretty accurate. You know, it looks fine. Yeah. Now, I'd prefer for that R and the G to do their own thing, but I think it looks pretty nice because the I and the G and the R, A, and G kind of go together. So that looks good. Now let's go through and add that nice glow they have going on. And mine's not going to look exactly the same because there's definitely some lights being used here, and these are 3D, and I'm not sure all this was done in After Effects, but I'm pretty sure most of it was. But I'm just going to go and add glow to each element because it's going to look good. I can just take the glow that I used over here on this guy. So the I and the G. And I'm definitely going to want to turn down the intensity a little bit and the radius. Okay. Threshold, probably mess with that a little bit too. I think that's looking good. Probably a little more intense. Yeah, okay. So now I will just copy that and apply it to the rest of them there. And there you go. Yeah. I mean, it's not going to be absolutely perfect. One of the things I really do admire about this is the very subtle highlights you can see on the text. I'm not exactly sure how I would do that with 2D text. I mean, maybe I could try using lights, but I don't think they would work properly. Probably use, like, what would I want to use? Probably not ambient. Maybe a point light. I don't need it to cast shadows, though. Okay, let's just see. I mean, maybe I can use lights here. No, that's not going to do its job. Yeah, being honest with you, I'm not 100% sure on how they got the, because these are definitely 3D. Like, if you take a look at the beginning, you can see that they're clearly 3D, which I could do that. I could probably just do that in Cinema 4D or Element, but that would be a lot of a longer video. So they're probably just doing it there. But yeah, that's definitely what. That's a key point to this that I'm not going to be able to cover, but, you know, hey, that's okay. Doesn't really matter. But now we have the glow going, so now, you know, each of the elements is kind of, like, carrying their own glow. And it looks pretty cool. You know, it's kind of filling in the gaps where glow needs to be. So that's cool. I think that looks good. And now for those lines, the kind of lines that come up, and I need to take a look here and see. Where that ends. So let's have that stretch on a little bit longer. I think I want to have this zoom out, like, a little bit more to, like, maybe 1,000. To, like, here. Okay, and I think I'm going to want to increase my composition time a little bit, probably like 35, I guess. I guess 35 will work. Sounds good. Okie doke. There we go. Okay. Let's increase those a little bit. Move that back. And I'm going to start adding my lines here. And the lines are also done through strokes, and they're being done through trim paths, which is a way to animate on just strokes. And we're just going to use a... I don't want to do this. I guess I could just use... I'll just use a rectangle. I'll just use a rectangle to do this, because I could just use the pen tool, but let's just use a rectangle. Because that will work just fine. Okay. Stroke is a little too high on this guy. Let's turn that down. Four, I think. Four will work. Yeah, by four. Okay, let's grab that. Let's make that a little bit less. Not as much. Let's just take a look here. You can see. Okay, so that needs to be stretching out to the S, so longer, actually. I'm not moving you. I'm trying to actually increase your size here. If you'll allow me to do so, sir. I guess not. I guess he does. Oh, I guess. Am I? Yes, I am. Nope. Come on now. Move your thing. There we go. Okay. You know what? I have a better way of doing this. I never like messing with those handles, so I just go to the scale and unlink them, and then just let me center my anchor point to the actual thing. And then I just kind of do it like that. I find it easier. So that looks fine to me. I think with that, I'm actually going to need to increase the stroke to maybe 5. Okay. Now, where exactly is this being placed in our scene? It's going to, like... It's not going to work exactly how it does in the example, or in the official one, because the font changes and differences. So we'll put it, like, directly below the point of that T. That should work fine. How's that look? Good. Is that where it's supposed to be? A little lower, I think. And now for the color here, I am just going to grab it out of the text. We go, and I will just apply the same glow to it. So there we go. That looks snazzy, and like I said, for trim paths, we are just going to open up our layer, add a trim path, and how am I going to want to do this? I'm going to want to do it the opposite way. So yeah, from the end, 0. And the thing that's cool about this one is it has a very fast easing to it. Ooh, this needs to be 3D as well. So it goes out. Oh, he messed up my thing, man. Moved it. Alright, well, it's whatever. That's fine. I'll just reposition that to where it needs to go. Messed up my thing. My computer's chugging right now. So hopefully. After Effects doesn't start to be in all, have to start being all slow on me. I'm trying to get a new computer right now because mine is garbage. Alright, that works. Just move that over to the right a little bit more. One more time. And down, probably like three little clicks of the arrow keys, and perfect. And now we will just go ahead and open up our trim paths and put that guy to like there. So it kinda Oh, way quicker than that. Actually, that's not what I'm looking for. How does this one come on? It's just like a reveal. Yeah, like the thing grows. So that would actually be done using scale. Actually, no, because it grows. It doesn't grow from the center. It grows from, well, if that's the case, then I could just move the anchor point. Okay. So it's not being done through trim paths. My mistake. I don't know why I thought that. It's actually being done through scale. Or at least in this case, that's how I would do it. I would move the anchor point over here so it scales out from that location. So yeah, that'll work. And I'll just set this to 0. I think my computer's chugging because of all that glow. So yeah, there we go. That's what I'm looking for. Perfect. Looks good. Alrighty. And we will simply just duplicate. What I'm going to do is on all of these, I'm just going to turn off their effects because my computer is not liking me at all right now, and I know it's because of the glow. But yeah, I'm just going to take this over and put it to be relatively the same way on the other side. I think that's fine as it is. I'm trying to get a look at it farther away. Yeah, there we go. And then at the top, there is just a straight line that comes across, and how far does it cover? It covers the entire thing. So, there we go. Cool, and now we will just do the same thing, but we'll just put this one at the top. And I believe the top one actually scales out from the center, so we will just need to reposition our anchor point to be in the center. And we'll just increase the scale. So, from here, we'll just put that guy there. And we are going to increase our scale so that it covers the entire thing. I believe it covers it a little bit farther. Yeah, it kind of goes out and beyond. We are getting a weird thing here. The stroke. That's fine, though. I kind of actually like how that looks. Like, since it's really scale, I guess that I could change that with the caps of the stroke. It's probably, the caps are probably different. So go in the rectangle, the stroke, and we have butt caps. So I could change that. And for projecting, I guess it's not doing a thing. I thought it would. That changes it a little bit. How's that look with the bevel? No, definitely not. Well, I kind of like that. I don't know about you guys. I kind of like how that looks. All right, and this one is going to happen slower. So exactly how do these come on? So, okay, the first, that one, the big one comes on first. Oh, and I actually need to reverse the anchor point on this one. I forgot to do that. I need to make it come in from the other side. So the anchor point comes in from there. So they should. That means I need to move the position. Excelente. Okay, let's just push that guy in a little bit. Out a little more. Okay. That looks good to me. Excellent. Yeah, the caps are a little weird on the end of this dude, but I don't really care. They look fine to me. The best way I could think about doing that movement would be through scale. I can't really think of another way to do that. And obviously, with the scale, it's going to kind of distort the stroke. I mean, maybe I need to, like, maybe decreasing the stroke would help. Changing it to 3 instead. No, that's just not doing a thing, but whatever. That's fine. Okay. Now I want to RAM preview this and see how all that looks together with the screen movement and the lines coming on. And it looks like we're nearing an hour. We might be over it. I'm not exactly sure. Because I think we started at midnight, like midnight 12:40 something, I believe that's the time we started. And now we're at 1:46. So the main concept is done within an hour, I think. I'm not exactly sure. It feels like an hour at least. But we definitely got, you know, we've got a lot of stuff done within this hour. Okay, what I'm looking at here is that the, maybe it'll, I'm not sure. I just feel like the screen isn't going out fast enough. Is this our RAM preview right now? Because if that's it, that's kind of slow. Okay, yeah, so I'm thinking that we need to make this a little bit faster, like entirely. Yeah, for sure. Okay, why is the screen movement doing that? I haven't, oh, is it? Huh, that's really weird. Are they Bezier? Is that what's going on? No, they're linear. See how it kind of speeds up at the end there? It's kind of weird. Don't know why you're doing that, buddy. Why are you getting all fast all of a sudden? No one asked you to do that. Because it's smooth throughout the entire thing. And then towards the end, it just gets super fast. Maybe I'm just insane. I'm not sure. But the one thing that I do know is that all of this needs to happen a little bit faster. So I'm kind of curious to see what it would look, what would happen if I kind of used like a time remap to kind of speed things up. I'm not sure if it would look bad or not, but I'm kind of curious to see because the movements are smooth, but I just need everything to happen a little bit quicker. So if I pre-compose all this stuff together, make it its own little composition, and then enable time remapping. And then bring that to like 15 seconds. How would that look? Because I feel like that would probably look fine because the movements are all smooth. They're just happening a little too slow for my taste. And I feel like as a viewer, if you were watching this intro and it were happening this slow, you would lose interest pretty quickly, and it would just need to happen a little bit faster. So I think the time remap should look fine. Just need to take a look. Yeah, it's definitely getting faster when the camera movement stops. So this is what it looks like with the time remap. Okay. So if anything, I need to move my time remap to be a little bit quicker. And I also need to go through and adjust a couple things. I think what I want to do on the camera angle is actually have it kind of like have it scale to a certain point. So within this point here, or maybe I just need... No, what I need is for it to be farther out in this position. And then over time, I could have it continue to go out. I'm just curious to see why exactly this is getting faster. It doesn't need to be. Did that fix it? I think that looks better. I'm getting the feeling that that one's looking better. So I'm gonna hit it with another RAM preview. And hopefully, I'm sorry these RAM previews are a little too slow for any of you guys that have God PCs. Because I don't. I'm saving up for one right now. Alright, well, let's see though. Okay, and if that's the case, I'm going to need my lines to come out faster. Alright. So that looks fine to me. I think the zoom needs to happen, like there needs to be a little more of it going on. Yeah, that should be fine. So we have the Stranger Things, all the letters coming in, and then the lines, and then about here, I want to start kind of. Yeah, there's clearly some kind of like Bezier thing going on that's just giving me an issue. But I'm not seeing anything to help me out with that. So, whatever. That's just an issue I'm having. I've had the exact same issue before, so that's nothing new. So yeah, I'll just have the fade out happen like here. So for the fade out, all I'm gonna do is have black cover it, because that's kind of the way that the fade happens in the official one. So it'll just go from 0 to 100. All right, cool. And now for this text, that font was Avant-Garde, I believe. I believe I only have it in one weight. So, let's see. It was Avant. Where did that? Maybe I didn't install it. I thought I did. If I don't, then I have tons of fonts that look like it. I guess not. What's the one I had? Monster Rat looks kind of like it. Where's Monster Rat at? I said I don't have Monster Rat. Saw like a bunch of fonts the other day. I guess Axis looks kind of like it. Yeah, for the most part, Axis looks like it. So I'll just use that one. And this one is not done with strokes. This one is done with just straight up white. So yeah, I'm gonna set my tracking to 0. I'll probably bring it in just a little bit. And so I only have this in one weight, so that's gonna have to do for this one. Well, you know, actually I'll just make my I'll just put Caleb Lancaster for created by, just because I can, just because I want to have my name on here, even though this isn't my idea. Still don't care though. I will just take this and I will put created by, and I'll do it in I think Coves. Looks kind of similar to it. Burial kind of look like it. Well, that's next to bold, actually. I think that looks pretty similar. It's not as light of a weight, but how about curvy? No. You know what? I'll use that one. I think I actually kind of like how that looks, so we'll just use that. So there we go. Created by Caleb Lancaster. Looks good. I kind of like put that in a little bit. There we go. All right, so for that fade, this is very simple. For the fade in with the red and the fade out with the red, we're going to animate fill. And I'm just gonna do it on one text layer and apply everything we do to the other one. So for Caleb Lancaster, we're just gonna do fill, where you at? There you are. Okay, so RGB. So now this is all red. And now I can animate the fill color to turn to white. So with the, it'll kind of just go with the fade. So fill color, turn that there, and very, you know, then like 10 frames, we'll turn it to white. And then it will go on like that. And then we will do opacity and make that last a little bit longer. So it kind of comes in like that. It's very, you know, it's a very subtle effect, but I do like it. It definitely gives off to me like an 80s vibe. For some reason, I might be wrong on that, but I remember a lot of movies kind of looking like that. Like the text kind of fading on like that. I just think it's a very subtle but cool effect. I'm a fan of it. So yeah, there we go. And then I will simply just kind of do it in reverse here. So it'll go back. So within 10 frames. Okay, that was fun. We'll turn this back to red. And then the actual opacity will go back down. Yeah, I like that. I think I kind of want to make the red kind of... sooner. Just a little bit sooner. Yeah, there it is. That's good. I like that. I'm a very big fan of the look. I'll probably be using that in future projects. Yeah, there it is. Alrighty. The created by actually needs that beginning red. So it comes on at the same time. Don't know why it's not pasting on there. Come on now. Oh no, the fill's there. It's just not doing it. Let's see. That's interesting. I will just do it myself then. That's weird. Okay. So I'll just delete that animator. And I will... Ooh, you know what? That's why it's not working. So if I were to put that back on there... Okay, I see. It's not working. Okay, I see. All I need to do is I just need to put this on to that animator one. Okay, and then you just delete animator two. There it is. Okay, so that should look fine. There we go. Stranger Things fades out. That goes in, fades out, and there we go. Am I missing anything? Is that all there was in that scene? The glow still needs to be there. Yeah, I get the feeling, and on this there is a very subtle flickering going on, and that can be achieved through a plugin called S_Flicker. I've always used Sapphire Flicker for flicker effects. All I would do is I would turn down the brightness from 1 to like 0.7, just so it gets a little bit darker. And this one, I'm gonna need it to be a little bit lower. Make the amplitude very low, and now it gives it a very, very subtle. I'll probably need to make the brightness darker. Very subtle flicker. I need to turn up the amplitude. And turn down the brightness slightly. Yeah, there it is. That's the effect I'm looking for. So you can, if you take a look, you can see the text is very, very subtly flickering. It looks cool. Again, more 80s inspiration from the guys that made this show. So that is pretty much it. That is the recreation of that part of the Stranger Things opening, because that's the one I thought I would have the most fun recreating. So yeah, that's pretty much it. This is the first episode of recreating. I had a little bit of a stumble with linear keyframes, like however long it was. I don't even know. I'm probably gonna cut that out because I was just like sitting here, like pretty silent, trying to figure out how to get the linear keyframes and not speed up. But I found a little workaround, so that's fine. But yeah, let me know what you guys think. If whatever I can improve on, or if you guys enjoyed it or not, because I thought it would be really fun to do. I mean, hey, if you don't enjoy it, then there's still tutorials are still gonna come out on this channel, so don't worry about that. But yeah, that is the Stranger Things recreation, and now after this, I will play out the fully rendered thing for you with the audio from the actual opening. And yeah, that's pretty much it. Thank you guys for watching, and that is it. Cool.